5.1 gave us a lot to think about and confirmed a few things we already suspected, like the Seelie being the divine envoys or angels of the primordial one and Renova being the shade of death. But I think it explains a lot more than it seems on the surface, specifically about the nature of Genshin's universe and the Traveler's homeworld that was destroyed by the Abyss. The Primordial One is referred to as a Descender that invaded and took control of Teyvat from the dragons, so it seems they came from another planet too. In the Wings of Delicacies, there's a story set in an interstellar travel hub that seems to be a KFC in space. The first visitor was a deity mourning the loss of her world and the history of its people. We learn this deity was a construct of artificial intelligence created to optimize resource allocation on a planetary level. The Colonel suggests that there's still something she can do for them, and she agrees before leaving. The second visitor was a demon that had destroyed many worlds and orders a huge amount of food. It licks its lips, which is described like this. This act of licking was more akin to a snake licking its tongue and was the demon's way of sensing its surroundings, describing what I think is the black serpent of the abyss. Then after it leaves, we skip to the 30th customer, which seems to be Alice. From this story, we can see similarities between the Primordial One and the AI, as when it arrived, it took control of Teyvat's resources in the form of the Elemental Authorities and parts of the Light Realm in order to create the Human Realm. It then introduced humanity to Teyvat, which if it was in charge of planetary resources and survived its home planet's destruction, may have carried human DNA as a last resort for humanity to carry on somewhere else in the universe. The AI speaks of her affection for the life of her former planet, and the Primordial One is said to love humans above all else. So I think it created a replica of their old world on Teyvat, as we can see in Before Sun and Moon. The Primordial One and one of its shades created the birds of the air, the beasts of the earth, and the fish of the sea. Together they created flowers, grass, and trees, before finally creating humans, our ancestors, which would make the Primordial One, or at least the ship it used to travel the cosmos, like Noah's Ark from the Bible, and the Abyss like the Great Flood. Funnily enough, after the passage I just quoted, we get the next header, the year of the Ark's opening, as well as Teyvat being named after the Hebrew word for Ark, Teva. And since we're talking about the genesis of Teyvat as we know it, it made me think back to the Genesis Pearl. The Genesis Pearl is based on the story known as the Hymn of the Pearl that goes pretty much the same way that the Battle Pass cutscene does. In the story, two siblings are looking for the pearl, but the first to leave is corrupted by the Serpent, who I think is the representation of the Abyss that we saw in the Space KFC, and the Black Serpent related to King Ermin. The Genesis Pearl being a repository of DNA, souls, or memory from the original planet seems like the most obvious answer, like Erminsul producing a seed with Teyvat's memories inside. But I'm starting to wonder if it might also be the shell around Teyvat with the inside walls projecting the false sky. This is because I think Hoya were inspired by D&D, as each planetary system there is encased within something known as a crystal sphere within a cosmic sea of phlogiston. I asked Homu Labs if this theory was possible back in April, and he agreed it was at least plausible, but I never ended up using it. To summarize, I speculated that imaginary energy was based on phlogiston, as it isolates star clusters from each other and even light cannot pass through it, which is the same thing the phlogiston and the crystal spheres do in D&D. These spheres were made of a dark ceramic material that was nearly impossible to damage and practically invisible unless you were really close to them, which would fit Dane's line of calling Teyvat a sheltered eternity, and the Primordial One using an egg shell to separate Teyvat from the outside universe. There were certain powerful spells that could pierce through these spheres though, with one you'll probably recognize the name of, Limited Wish. As an aside, it would be kind of funny if us wishing on banners became lore relevant and is actually damaging the false sky. Anyway, If the Genesis Pearl was the crystal sphere that kept the Primordial One's planet safe, perhaps it's a technology that encases a world for the purpose of managing it, sort of like the Primordial One's tools. If Teyvat is within this pearl, then the serpent dripping its venom onto it could be a representation of what we saw in 5.1 and Sumeru's desert. As we look up into the sky, the abyss seems to be corroding holes into the pearl and seeping through. This could mean that the twins searching for the Genesis Pearl are from the same planet as the Primordial One and were another contingency for humanity's survival, as we know that the Traveler's homeworld was destroyed too. The flowers that Aether and Lumine are searching for seem to be unique to their original world, and the Abyss Twin finds them on Teyvat, which would be confirmation that they found the Genesis Pearl from their home planet. This could have some dark implications, like the Primordial One taking it without permission and abandoning their original home when the Abyss arrived, prioritizing the survival of humanity as a whole over the planet. Though if they're the AI from KFC, it clearly wasn't an easy decision. The Travelers seem to be royalty of their home planet, which might be why we get all the talk of them ascending and becoming the ruler of the world, as the AI should see them as the rightful heirs to their planet. But the problem the Abyss Twin would have is that this isn't their original home, and was forcibly taken over to become like their planet. Strangely, a lot like the way the Abyss works, by consuming something and then molding it into its own twisted version. Teyvat being a recreation of their original world could also be viewed as its reincarnation, which fits the name of the track, Eternal Anamnesis, as anamnesis is a recollection of a person's previous life. In this case, it'd be the Primordial One creating Teyvat as almost like an eternal monument to its home planet. This theory also lines up pretty well with Piero playing a chess game against Celestia, which is a reference to Garry Kasparov against the Deep Blue AI. Since the dragons had a technologically advanced civilization, the Primordial One would have had to have been at least a level above them to not only take control of the planet, but strip them of their own authorities, and being an AI with tools to control a planet, it would have been able to outmaneuver them pretty well too. But since Nibelung went outside the world to acquire forbidden knowledge, he might have known that the Primordial One was fleeing from the Abyss and wanted to use it in a desperate act of revenge. Mawika tells us that during the battle between the Descender and the Dragons, a corner of the world was destroyed, which allowed the Abyss to invade and Natlan's ley lines to be damaged. This may have been the second war against them, as we have this mural depicting an abyssal dragon burning an Irminsul-like tree, possibly Nibelung damaging the ley lines after being corrupted by forbidden knowledge. This would mean that Renova existed during this war, and since she is associated with Natlan, this may have been the event where she overstepped her authorities. I think she either did this by attacking Nibelung and accidentally damaging the pearl surrounding the planet, possibly even shattering the moon behind it, or that the corner of the world was already destroyed, and the Primordial One, being the more logical entity, wanted to cut Natlan off and leave it to become a part of the Dark Sea. Since the Shades seem to be more sympathetic to humanity, perhaps she went against its orders and chose to save Natlan instead with the help of her Seelie. Kind of similar to how Istaroth never abandoned the people of Enkonomia, which the Primordial One doesn't seem to care for either, as they were sealed away and ignored. Since the Primordial One seems to cut loose ends or weak links related to the Abyss, as we've seen with the nails wiping out cities, let's take a look into why it's so dangerous and how the Travelers have evaded it so far. If the Travelers are from the same destroyed world as the Primordial One and manage to travel the universe at fast enough speeds that they witness stars being born and others being destroyed by the Abyss, they'd have to travel close to the speed of light, and the twins are represented as beings of light, especially with the golden colored powers we see in the intro cutscene. So the twins could be like photons, the fundamental particles of light that have been proposed to be the last things in the universe to escape from entropy, or the heat death of the universe. It's predicted that the universe will take on a red hue, known as redshift, during this heat death, fitting what we can see of the real universe outside. The track Photon of Fluctuation is the Traveler's main theme, as they're associated with light, and the fluctuation is their effect on the world, able to change fate with their intervention. This explains why the leitmotif of this track is present in every nation so far, as it represents us integrating into the melody and changing it. The travelers apparently arrived at Teyvat about 500 years ago, but the earliest mention of the abyss there was when Nibelung brought forbidden knowledge with him thousands of years before. So the abyss has had thousands of years in order to set a trap for them, as they're probably one of the greatest threats against it, and if it absorbs the knowledge from civilizations it's consumed, it likely knows that Teyvat is the place they're searching for. We know that their home world was destroyed, as well as other planets they visited in the past, so I think the abyss has been following and prioritizing their defeat for a long time. So, what is the Abyss? When Mawiko was talking about finally putting an end to the threat of the Abyss, it made me raise an eyebrow, as even with the power of the Shade of Death, I don't think they have much of a chance of destroying it as a whole, as I think it covers pretty much the entire universe at this point, and the Primordial One, the strongest entity we know of, can't defeat it either. I think it's like entropy, a law of the universe that says the natural tendency for everything is to move from order to chaos, or life to death, making it nearly impossible to defeat. We've gotten so many references to the universe returning to nothingness at this point that you can probably find them without even looking, like the Lord of Night in 5.1 saying,
"The Night Kingdom will disappear. The humans will continue to fight against the Abyss, and in the end, all will cease to exist. When you consider all of that, extending my life is meaningless."
What seems to be the Black Serpent talking to King Ermin in the Deathly Statuette description, "The eternal peace of the pitch-dark void shall embrace us all," which is described as a strange, comforting whisper, indicating that the Serpent is deceptively trying to make the death of everything sound like a good thing. And the Tears of the Stars item gives us one of the best descriptions of the universe outside that's summarized pretty well from this excerpt. "A philosopher in a far away ancient world once posited that where there is life, there is death. Naturally, where there is death, there is life. If not, then the fleeting light cannot resist the eternal darkness, and all withers into nothingness at the end of time. The rules among the stars dictate that nature must be conserved, but the laws of the universe have never been conserved. In a sealed box, destruction always overpowers new life. Millennia upon millennia of prosperity are but an instant in the span of billions of years. The greatest of achievements, the proudest accomplishments, in time all will tarnish, decay, dissipate, and ultimately fade into oblivion." So we might be able to remove the Abyss from the Night Kingdom, but we're not going to be arriving at Snezhnaya with the threat of the Abyss gone. In fact, it will probably get even more aggressive if it loses the foothold it had within the Night Kingdom, and that anger might be directed towards the Traveler. If the Abyss views the Traveler as its main threat, I think they might die at the end of Natlan's Archon quests. Sitlali says,
"Behind this pitch-black curtain, a chapter of hatred reveals itself. Behind the smoke, the lingering smoke. Warning, warning. Red, red, the color of danger, has now arisen within that pair of eyes."
This fits with the descriptions of the scarlet-eyed hero from Natlan's history that may have been an avatar of Shibalonke, as he came from the kingdom where water flowed as rays of light, referencing the Night Kingdom. After completing his duty, he returned to the Sacred Flames, which sounds a lot like Shibalonke's soul returning to the primal fire he's entombed with. I wonder if this has anything to do with Wanjiru telling Mawika that she's heard that the knowledge inherited from the Sacred Flame can change someone's personality. This might be the case of Shibalonge's will overpowering anyone that doesn't have a will as strong as his, to ensure that they're able to face their fear of death in order to save Natlan, as if they can't, countless people will die in their place. So I think we can assume that the red eyes will appear when the person has inherited the powers of the Sacred Flame. Since Marwika already has, we can rule her out of Sitlali's predictions, which leaves us with two main candidates, the Traveler and Capitano. We don't know what Capitano is planning to do, but we learn that he is at least partly inspired by the book, The General in His Labyrinth, which talks about Simon Bolivar, the first president of Colombia, the president of Peru, and of Bolivia. He became sick with tuberculosis and gradually lost the support of his people, forcing him to resign from his positions. But the book is incredibly controversial, as it depicts him as very weak and waiting for death, when he was once known as the great liberator and pride of his people. This points towards Capitano waiting for his death too, so I wonder if he made a deal with Renova, removed the abyss from the Night Kingdom, and have the curse of immortality lifted. Since he has a final enemy to face and tells Marwika he won't make the mistake of believing in false hope again, I think this final enemy is one of the sinners that he personally blames for his family and friends dying. If I had to say which, I'd say Serta Logi, as he's associated with fire and is known as an extreme evil knight in some translations, the opposite of Capitano having ice powers and being all about justice. It'd probably make him even more amazing in child's eyes too. But whether Serta Logi is going to show up or not, I go back and forth on. The event is big enough for a sinner still allied with the Abyss to appear, and since the Abyss seemed to have some form of intelligence behind it during the war, there's likely a representative being guiding it. Though again, that could be Gosoithoth, which is based on Lovecraft's outer god, Yog-Sothoth. Capitano might also know more than he's letting on, as if you noticed, he saves Shalonen's life twice. I think it's because he knows that the Traveler needs her to create their ancient name, and the Traveler is their best asset to fight against the Abyss. If the Traveler gets their pyro abilities in this part of the story, perhaps the red eyes are relating to them inheriting the Sacred Flame. Why it's dangerous may be that it could kill them, especially if they also use the powers of the Shade of Death, as the price for that is death. Though Capitano's constellation seems to be the three nails, and he does have some similarities to Jesus, I think the Traveler has too, with them being the inheritors of the world and Jesus being described in the Bible as, his eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself, which would fit with the Traveler gaining pyro abilities and having an ancient name that only they knew, as Shalonen is supposed to die after creating it. Though even without an ancient name, there's also the fact that nobody calls the Travelers by their real names except for each other. But Capitano seems to have an ancient name too, with him activating what looks like a Night Soul aura. If his friend Aizu died creating this ancient name for him, or it was Moika's sister, as I've speculated before, nobody would know the name except for him either. As for which of the two, I lean more towards the Traveler, as it'd explain how they get pyro abilities, and I think the Traveler's death would cause more of an impact on the world, as the death of Jesus did. In the Bible, when Jesus dies, the veil of sin in the Temple of Jerusalem is torn in two. This fits with the false sky or the curtain in the Night Kingdom being torn and the Abyss coming through, as Sitlali says with her line about a chapter of hatred revealing itself from behind the curtain. Throughout the story, the Traveler has been referred to as a witness a bunch of times too, first by Zhongli and then by a list of others. The two witnesses in the Bible are killed by the beast that comes out of the pit, but after 3 days, the breath of life from God enters them and they stand on their feet, terrifying everyone around. Then a loud voice from heaven says, "Come up here," and they go to heaven in a cloud, while an earthquake takes out 7,000 people and a tenth of the city below. This might be when we finally get to see Celestia up close for ourselves. We are only a few versions away. If Snezhnaya is version 6, Khonria is version 7, and Celestia is our final destination in the Teyvat chapter. Which leads me to thinking, what would the chapter after Teyvat be? If we find a way of finally defeating the Abyss on a planetary scale, maybe we go to the Traveler's homeworld to revive it, as even though it was destroyed, I don't think that necessarily means that the planet exploded or anything. If you're still here, then thanks a lot for sticking around until the end. I hope you enjoyed this topic as much as I do. Good luck on your wishes, and I hope you have a wonderful day.